Thank you for your time and your presence, and thank you for your existence and coming in here from New York. Thank you, Heinz. This exhibition is very intimate, very personal. Normally, every exhibition is a personal exhibition, but I think this one is very intimate. So we would like to discuss on this exhibition's main themes and some subjects and objects around it. And curator Mr. Heinz and one of the main persons of this artwork, Mrs. Roja, is here, and we have some questions, of course, and we would like to get your questions after the talk. The talk will be around 1 hour, and after then, please give us your questions. So I would like to start with Mrs. Shirin Neshat. Thank you again. I would like to ask about the main themes of this exhibition. Some terms are very important, like motherland, like motherhood, like presence, like being in exile. What would you like to say to us around these terms or artifacts, perhaps?
First of all, I wanted to say, can you hear me? Thank you for coming. I see a lot of women. Thank you, and also it's a really privilege to come back to Istanbul, especially now. And I thank Hazar to give me the honor to take over this space. And thank you, Heinz, for the second time of collaborating in exhibiting in Istanbul. There are many things to say about this work, but maybe some of you know my work. It's always a hybrid of my personal anxieties and issues as a woman, as an Iranian on this planet, but also a larger social anxiety about the world that I live in, whether it is in the United States, here, Iran, etc. So in this work, I made 3 videos that are really about a series of dreams, and some of them are my own personal dreams. And the reason I decided pursuing this kind of narrative is because I think in my dreams, and I'm sure in some of you, you agree that in our dreams we're really naked, that we are most truthful, and everything that we are afraid of somehow visits us in our dreams. And everything we hope for that is positive also visits us in our dreams. And I've been writing my dreams over the years, and I have found that one thing is always consistent in my dreams is my mother, is a mother figure. And I never understood that very well. Roja, the video is based in my own dream. And the other videos that I made that is not here, there is a recurring appearance of a mother. And for me, for sure, as an Iranian living in exile, I think my mother is the last attachment to the country. And sometimes, sadly, I think if she passes away, my deepest connection to the country will finish. But on another level, I think a motherland. It's naturally my obsession with this desire of union and being reunited with a family. So for example, with Roja and all of the women, I think in the film embody who I am, what I feel, the emotions, the experience. And I think with Roja, it speaks about my deepest sadness of this nostalgia, this idea of how even my subconscious in my dreams, I'm divided between the country I live, which is the United States, the people who I have made friends and have become a part of my country, but I feel deeply alienated, that they're strangers to me still after all these years, and yet I love them. I feel the humanity in the Americans. And yet, when I look the other side in the desert, I see my mother running toward me, and there is this immediate connection to Iran, to the landscape of the desert, to a woman who's desperately trying to reach me and can't. And so these are, I think, ideas that have visited me in my dreams, and I wondered if I could create a narrative that simply communicates the emotions to the people, but not to be heavy, not to... And it is difficult because dreams are meant to be fragmented. They're abstract, they're obscure. They're references of reality, people you know, places you have been, but nothing makes sense. And therefore, I decided to make films that don't really have realistic meanings, but they have symbolic meanings. And really, I could say the same about Sara. It's really my anxiety, and I think everybody here, of violence, of mortality, of genocide. And this is a woman that is entrapped in a place that she sees residues of death, destruction, war. And she questions, am I alive or dead? So these are just some of the ideas that I wanted to point.
The position of in-betweenness around the real and surreal world, and consciousness and subconsciousness, is very delicate and valuable and fragile. Mrs. Roja, I would like to ask that your experience, when you see the work, how did you feel?
when I see the work? I've seen the work only a few times now. And actually, I'm surprised that I'm still kind of hypnotized by it every time, to be honest. I'm looking at myself, but I don't know. It's not exactly me. It's more just part of the art. I don't know. Otherwise, I also... But I do feel the emotion again. I get kind of transported back to those few days where we were doing that. So once I see it once, I'd like to kind of step outside for a few minutes.
But that was your
mom. And that was my own mom. So I also feel nice when I see her, if I'm all the way in Istanbul or in South Africa or something, and I see her, I do actually feel that comfort of, oh, there's my mom, that's good. You know, makes me feel comfortable.
Do you sense or feel any kind of allegory to the real world, to the real agenda of, you know, world issues?
Yeah, I think this in-betweenness that Shirin speaks about in her work is something that I've lived and experienced as well. You know, I was born in Iran, but I'm raised in New York City. I've been there since I was 8 years old. And while my experience is slightly different than Shirin's, because I really did grow up in America, it still resonates, which is, you know, you would think by now I'm just completely American and you're done with it, but that it's not true. You're still kind of always have this double consciousness. And it's actually more bizarre for me because I am so American. But when I go to Iran, I'm American. In America, I'm Iranian. And so there's always this, you know, thinking about what is that in-betweenness, which is why when we made the film, the moment she told me, I was like, oh, I understand what you want.
And Heinz, what is your ideas around these sentences?
I think it's very important to hear this in between, or how do you say in English, you say a dilemma. The dilemma which is there because you are in between two cultures, two educations, two environments, and your identity is not, you cannot identify it with only one culture and one past, one history. So I think it's this in-between is also very important for Shirin's work, always, because it was always autobiographical, coming out of her dreams, coming using her own face. So it's in between the autobiographical, very personal, and what is happening in the world, the situation she is in, the political situation of the country she's living in or she's left. So I think in between is really the key word to the whole thing, including even the installation here, because we are in between the two films.
And also the blurness is a very great effect and result of this exhibition. What do you see in the depth of blurness?
Of learning?
Blurness, I mean, the images in the entrance.
Mm-hmm.
They are American people from the rural areas, I think. And which America do you see?
I see an America which we very often forget, because we think very often of America. When we say America, we mean New York, the West Coast, or we mean Los Angeles, the West Coast, or New York, the East Coast. And we forget that America is very big, that the profound America, the deep America, has nothing to do with the cities we mention and maybe we know. So I think it's these portraits we have of these people, there is something very humanistic about it, because it's a curious look on people which are, they can be Americans, they can be Turkish, they can be in Anatolia, they can be in upstate New York, somewhere
it's a kind of
reduced state to pure existence, let's say. They're pure humans.
So it's a reflection of a state of mind, perhaps, global state of mind.
A global state of mind and a global potential of humanity also, which is independent from whatever conflicts there might be, which is independent from your situation of being in between two cultures. It's something which is more global and which is like a meta level to the problems you live in every day of your life, I think.
Shirin?
Well, I think what I tried with these photographs, because my photographs are always human portraits. And for me, what's really important that I try to capture is the fragility of human nature, whether they're American, Iranian, Turkish. And really, I think there's both a demonic and a positive nature to all of us. And these photographs are for sure from the perspective of a non-American, an Iranian, looking into a community that I could never feel completely connected with. But I see their humanity. I see how different we are. I see their spirituality. I see their evilness. And in the video of Roja, equally the singer, the way we characterized the singer, at first he was very humane and made her even cry because the song that he was singing was so beautiful and so emotionally provocative, talking about, I would love you until you die. There is a part of American culture I love and I identify with. But then he turned into a monster and he turned into a racist. And the same as the mother, where she came toward her and embraced her, but then she turned into a monster. So I really think, as an artist, I never seen anything in total absolute. Who's the evil? Who is the good? Even the Iranian government or the fanatics, I always had a hard time really directly pointing a finger, because I'm hoping that there is a humanistic nature in all of us that we cannot generalize as, you know, good or bad. So I think going back to these portraits, they're very different for me. They have no calligraphy. They were very difficult, and I thought most people don't like them, maybe, because they're not my signature work. But to me, they became an extension of the video, an extension of the way in which I represented the American people for the first time in my work.
Heinz, I would like to ask the theme of the other. What is happening now around the term of other in these days in art world and social agendas of ours? You know, Europe is very disturbed in these days, and US also, perhaps. What's happening?
That's a very simple question, but it takes at least 2 days to answer it. I don't know what's happening. I only know that we are shifting into a period where we do not know what is going to happen in the next moment. So it's in Sao Paulo, you have the last Biennale had a very beautiful name because it was dedicated to the uncertainty. Everything is uncertain today. So this has threatening aspects and it has good aspects. I think for art it's a good time because everything is uncertain. So politically, I agree with you, whether you are in Europe, whether you are in Trump America, whether you are in Turkey, whether you are in China, everywhere you have shifts, things happening every or changing every day, and you don't know where it is going. And for us, the problem, or for my generation, the problem is that I grew up without a war, with peace, with prosperity, economical security, and all this is today threatened. But I could never say what is really happening. Nobody knows. But we are not used to these shifts and to these changings. This is why the uncertainty is an emotion which gives us really insecurity also.
Shirin, do you think that this is a kind of opportunity for us, for the future?
I don't know. I think, like Heinz said, I live with a lot of fear. Now I live in New York, and you know that being Iranian or being a Muslim immigrant is hugely problematic. I have never been worried about being an American citizen as an Iranian. Now I am worried. And I've never felt racism until today in America. That's terrifying. I never felt never thought we could have Trump as our president. We do. So I think Heinz defined it beautifully, that there is a lot of uncertainty and there is a lot of anxiety for people like us, because where do we go? You know, we are the future refugees. Do we go? I cannot even go back to Iran. So where do we belong? And there's incredible threat to the world of a largest population of Muslims living in America that eventually could have to leave, like the Jews were in danger during the Nazis. So really, there's no doubt. We were talking earlier that we both have American passports, but going back to US, we're a little nervous, you know? So this is an amazing change in the American history, where it's made of immigrants, and somehow many of us have been cornered. And so it's a very serious anxiety to have. But like Heinz said, I think this gives a lot of opportunity for culture, for people who are artists, whose lives are at risk, or actually everything that is happening in the world directly affects their reality, their psychology, their immediate existence. To make art, I think, or theater or music or whatever, that somehow elaborates on those level of anxiety, but also hopes, and to make sense of the world. And I've always felt as an Iranian, because I'm Iranian, that I had a footing in questioning political issues, but deeply personal anxieties. And I think maybe even in America, art culture would change, because for too long, it's been about money, commodity, commercial value, artists getting richer and richer. And now suddenly American public artists are waking up that, oh my God, you know, even our freedom of expression is in jeopardy in America. And this is really terrifying. So I think we will see a new move of artists being vocal and finding they have a great responsibility. Again, being an Iranian, we've already had that, because we never took art lightly, whether we're a filmmaker or a visual artist. It was always socially conscious. But I think in the larger Western world that is so much about auctions and market, which is not bad. I'm sitting here in a very nice gallery, but I think there is a way that artists could be engaged in socially conscious issues that we haven't seen for the past decade or more. And we will have to wait and see, like Heinz said, is uncertain.
Heinz, I would like to ask the identity of the art places, art spaces. How do you define a gallery and a museum today? Did they change? Did their mission change, vision change? What do you see?
I grew up with the art of the 70s and the art world of the 70s. And the 70s, in my opinion, were very important because art, contemporary art, reflected what was going on in society. And the art world also existed. So the galleries were the experimental places, and the museums were the places where I wouldn't say the more official art, but the recognized art was shown. And this has a little bit changed in the 80s. The galleries, since the 80s, have become, in my opinion, much more commercial. And also the art in many senses has become more, I would say, conformist. You know, there's a very beautiful thing that the French artist Daniel Buren once said. He said that every artwork which is exhibited is political. You can have the most abstract painting, but as soon as it is exhibited in a gallery or a museum or elsewhere, it is political because it's a political statement. Even if you want it to be not political, you make a political statement. Even if you don't go to elections, this is also a political statement. So, as I said, this was very evident and visible in the 70s, and I think maybe it's not bad for contemporary art if this is coming back a little bit, so that the galleries become again places where you see more experimental, more innovative, more extravagant art also, and not only more commercial art. And the museums have a big problem at the moment, not so much in Turkey, because here you have a lot of private museums. But in countries like France or Germany, you did not have private museums, and more private collectors are doing their museums, which is dangerous and good at the same time. It's dangerous because it can, it might help the market to be more and more commercial. It might help certain people to use art not for cultural purposes, but for speculation purposes. So I think the what we said before, that the political situation or our everyday life is shifting at the moment, for the art world it's the same. There is also a certain uncertainty, and I think this is positive because it has become too commercial in these last years. So we are going back to something which reflects more all the problems in everyday life and in politics.
Shirin, where do you feel much more free, in a gallery or a museum?
I think filmmaking has been my second love. I started to make a movie, Women Without Men, as a reaction against galleries and museums, because I came to art unexpectedly, and suddenly I found myself in the art world, the biennials, my work selling here for this and that. And I felt something hypocritical about my subject matter and where I started. And I felt that I became slowly this person who made these commodities, these photographs that I wrote on it and sold, and I went this show, that show. So I decided to stop and take a back seat. The audience of cinema, it's extremely different than the audience of the art world. First of all, I don't make money from filmmaking. Filmmaking is not an investment. And the viewer who comes to see it has a very different relationship. It's not a commodity, it's an experience, it's a storytelling. Cinema has a mass culture as an audience. It's not an exclusive, educated audience that knows about art history. And I think maybe other people can contradict this, but my move towards cinema, and now I've just finished a new film that we're editing, is because I wanted to push beyond the boundary of galleries and museums and to really make a film that even my own mother could see and understand. So I think there's not just a problem with galleries and museums, there is a problem with the audience of art, that really their relationship to art, to me, is problematic. And sometimes too quick, there's not enough reflection. I speak as an artist, and so therefore I make films that it takes me 6 years to make, and it yet, you know, it's released theatrically, and the people who go see it don't know me as a gallery artist. And so I inherited a new audience that I think, for me selfishly, it's interesting. So I'm taking a risk. Another thing I wanted to, since we're going, very interesting questions you ask, also being a woman artist, we have to keep in mind that it's been a challenge of being a Middle Eastern artist, but a woman Middle Eastern artist in a world that is dominated by men, even in the West. So the challenges have been multiple for me, and so I've had to really figure out a lot of these issues.
Roger, how did you meet?
I actually met Shirin and Shoja in Morocco when I was about 17 years old. My uncle lives there and he's worked with them in the past, and I was there for the summer to learn some French, and they came to Location Scout for one of their earlier works, and I ended up, you know, going around with them and translating a little bit for them, and then other than that, we're, you know, close family friends since then in New York, you know. Persian New Year, you see each other and you have dinners, and so they're basically like aunties and uncles, you know, for people who don't live in their own country.
I think she has the most beautiful eyes in the world. I took pictures of her. She became my muse a few years ago because I think the camera loves Roja. I think you agree. And also her expression, there is a sadness to her gaze that somehow I very rarely see in people. And so when I started to take a photograph, I thought, I have to do another project with her. So it worked. And then her mother agreed to be the other role. So I was very happy.
Hans, I would like to get your comment in Shirin's visual language around choosing the black and white. What is your opinion, your thoughts?
Well, do we dream in black and white or color? I think, and I want to add what Shirin said before, because I do not completely agree with the audience, which is different in cinema and in museums, because I think thanks to artists like Shirin who work with film, there is a new audience coming to museums and galleries, which comes through film, because film is universally in the whole world, you can understand these images. Mm. I think the black and white is a style which goes back to expressionist films, yeah, and which is sort of, this is why I asked for the dreams, it's different from reality, and it gives reality a certain stylish look, which is like a stylish, or maybe stylish is not the word, but which is a special philosophy about looking at reality. And this is here in these two examples augmented by the effect that you work with certain filter-like, gelatin-like optical tricks to enforce or reinforce this idea of dream, not realistic thing. I think black and white today is not only in Shirin's work, very important for people who really want to do something which goes to our subconsciousness and which makes a difference with the world we're living in, which is not realistic. Maybe you don't agree with that, but I have this impression.
Any other suggestions or thoughts?
I just, since we're talking about aesthetics and the visual, I looked a lot at surrealist filmmakers, the work of Man Ray, a photographer who experimented film using glass over the camera, Bunuel, Jean Cocteau, Maya Deren, experimental filmmaker from America from the 70s. I think, like Heinz said, in thinking about the theme of dreams and really staying away from the realism and being in this boundary between illusion and reality, it was absolutely important for me to stay away from color. Color to me, it's seductive, it's dangerously beautiful. And for me, the black and white is severe. And I think even more powerful in nature, in the forest. There's something very haunting when you see no green in the trees, when you're talking about a nightmare of a woman. So we wanted to create almost this haunting experiences that was not possible with color.
Um, Perhaps we should talk about the lens for the audience. Empathy is a very important thing when someone experiences an artwork. And Shirin, in this exhibition, Shirin had done a very hard job. She tries to see and understand the other. Do you agree?
I agree with you that empathy is very important, but it's also very dangerous. So on the one hand, the works try to understand better the other and herself too, because as we said before, it's very autobiographical, coming out of her own dreams. On the other side, the stylish black and white, which takes away the seductiveness of colors, also makes it, which sounds maybe a little paradox, but it makes it less sentimental. So, because it's more artificial than it would be in color. So, the empathy for the situations which are described and shown and for the people who play and who appear is in my sense, at least, also something which has to be broken a little bit. So on the one hand, you feel with, you identify. On the other hand, you keep a certain distance at the same time. And this is also through these aesthetical means. It's also through the way she uses the lenses, she manipulates the image. It's something where you put a certain distance to whatever situation you might identify with.
Is it a kind of a respectful distance, or because of a kind of afraid?
No, I don't know whether respectful would be the word. I think it's something. If you do very emotional work like Shirin does, you need also a formal distance to break the emotion a little bit, to keep distance to the emotion, to avoid it a little bit. That's a distance. I don't know whether respectful would be the word. It keeps you on the distance and it gets you nearer at the same time.
I have to say, it's a really interesting point, because I think when work of art is very emotional and very beautiful, it's very dangerous, because it can be very sentimental and melodramatic. And this is something that, and also because it's personal, and it can get really bad, let's be honest. And so for me, it's always how to maintain a balance between an emotion that the audience could feel and be moved without being manipulative and over-sentimental or overly autobiographical. And I think you're right. Even with the music, for example, we were very careful not to have very romantic music. So the music had to be equally disturbing, because there's a lot of pain in the work. So therefore, there's a lot of emotions. But how can you convey those amount of pain and emotions without being too cheesy and without being manipulative and sentimental? This is the biggest challenge I find. And it's like poetry. Poetry that it touches you in a philosophical way, from poetry that is didactic and it's one-liner. I think this is my biggest challenge, because I like beautiful images, compositions, aesthetics, emotions, but I always have to be careful not to go overboard, you see? And I'm sure there are people who are turned off by my work because there's too much emotion, too much beauty, and I can understand that. But I'm very much always questioning that boundary where I don't go over. So, for example, with the camera work, with the music, with the acting, even when she cried, I was like, should we have her cry? But I thought it was important. So I really, with the editing, and Shoja, my partner, is here who helped me putting the story together and editing it. We were so careful about the degree of sentimentality.
Does your generosity comes from? Because you share your dreams with us.
Well, I can say this much, that I think I'm most effective when I'm really honest. Like every one of you, I am someone inside here and what I am outside. I feel there's something we all hide in terms of who we are to ourselves, our inner world, and who we are to the public. And I think an artist is only really good when they can really let go of a little bit. And I am a very self-conscious, nervous, insecure, fragile person. It's not about generosity, it's about being naked, being truthful to the audience, because I think at the end, if you're really naked, then the audience can maybe identify with some of the issues. And again, I don't mean to say this in a sentimental way, but I think my work has always been personal. So the driving force comes from my experience as a human being on this planet, and I'm sharing it not because it's interesting, because my life is not that interesting, really. My issues as a person, but I think it's actually common human experiences that other people might share, you see. So it's not about generosity, it's about finding the thread.
The title of the exhibition also a tragic allegory for today's agendas, and it reminds me the, you know, Martin Luther King's famous sentence, you know, I have a dream. So what is your dream in these days?
I won't tell you. I think there are dreams and there are nightmares. There are good dreams and bad dreams. And again, we are with the in-between here, because what's happening, for instance, with Roja, who meets her mother and gets pushed back, it's not a dream, it's a nightmare to be pushed back by your own mother, so to say. So I think it's really important to never simplify things and say dreamers are only dreamers, because the way, Shirin, you photograph the or film the dream audience, for instance, by overexposure, so you, it's not a realistic, beautiful dream. It's something which is very strange and might become very easily nightmarish. I think this is one of the qualities of the work, that it doesn't simplify things and go only one direction.
Any other thoughts? Here's another question. When we see the films, we experience a kind of interchange between stage and the real world. Do you think that this is a kind of a criticism of our problems of daily, how can I say it? Daily jobs of ideas, you know. We have lots of ideas in these days. These days, you know, as a father, you know, or as a businessman, etc. So we see a stage, and a person comes to the stage and tells that, come here, I mean the older person. What is your thoughts around stage and the real world?
As I said before, for me contemporary art is very essential when it reflects what is going on in its period. so or in its era. So the real world, for me, that's my personal opinion, I'm not so interested in realistic representation of the real world. I like the stage and I like art because, or love art because, it's like a looking glass through art that the artist watches the real world. So it's completely different, but it reflects the real world. And I think this is important. And this is also why it's in, how do you say in English, in French you say mise en scène. So art, artificial, artistic, artifact, it's all together. It's one thing. It's not realistic, in my opinion. And it's important that the real world is reflected in a formal way, which is not just a reproduction of the real world. This is why we need the stage and we need the artifact, the looking glass the artist uses to watch and analyze the real world.
So the mirror of the truth is the stage.
Stage is one tool to be a mirror. The looking glass is another mirror. Black and white is another way, another tool of being a mirror and not a reproduction of reality. So all this comes together. You know, there is a formal experimentation which is linked to the work. It's not a one-to-one reproduction.
Any other thoughts, Chi?
The last thing I want to say, I don't know how it connects to what you ask, but this is the first time I make work that is about the Western culture. I've never made work that was outside of the Iranian society, and I don't know why, but I felt the urge to question my own perspective to the American people, the American landscape, American politics, and I think that when I think about the composition of the film, the stage, the man who Roger listened to and was mesmerized by, I think is my experience of being an outsider in an American society and trying to understand my situation, the rhetorics, the people, everything. So. And it's very strange timing because I've been in America longer than I've been in my own country. But I've now finally made work that remarks on my perspective and look the lens into the American culture. And I think I don't really have all the answers, in fact, but I think it just intuitively I felt like I had to do this.
Perhaps sometimes the questions more important than the answers. So perhaps we can take some questions.
Hello, thank you for coming. It's very exciting to have you here. My question is, do you think that you always felt like an outsider or a foreigner in both countries because they're so strikingly different from one another? And are there places like Istanbul where you feel, let's say, more at home because it's kind of in the middle culturally? Turkey is similar to Iran, but I guess it's still more accessible to the Western world. Would you want to move here?
Bad. I have officially been living in exile since 1996, but I left Iran when I was young and I went back a few times. And yes, it's been a very difficult experience, and we've made a life for ourselves in America. We have a very large Iranian community in New York. But my family are still in Iran. In fact, Istanbul is the only place we meet. Right now, my sister is here in Istanbul because she knew I was here 3 years ago when Dirimart had a show. 15 of them came here. So Turkey actually is the last place I saw my father. He came also to see me before he went and he passed away. It's a very emotional place for me because it's the closest I can get to Iran. But also it's a country that feels familiar to me. The sound of the Azan, the bazaar, the people, the Esterlah, Taksim. I've shot a video here. I've endlessly feel at home. And I'm very invested in what's going on in this country. Like many Iranian people, we looked in Turkey as a country of moderation, democracy, tolerance of religions and ethnicities and everything. I'm very concerned. So needless to say, I feel emotionally extremely connected. That's why I would have never missed coming to Istanbul for this exhibition. Even though people said, don't go to Istanbul, don't leave US because of the passport problem. Don't go to Istanbul because there's a problem. Even my own mother in Iran. But I think it's so important, even particularly today, that we don't let fear take over us. I'm afraid even America. I'm like editing in Paris. I'm scared of Paris. I'm scared of going back to Iran. We're afraid of everywhere. So, hey, you know, and I have to say, yes, if I had to leave the United States, Turkey would be a very serious consideration if they give me residency.
Well, I understand that you're banned to go back to your home country. Is it true? Well, my question is, lately, the big news channels, televisions, big papers, they were banned to enter into White House by Trump administration. Do you think of one day, if he doesn't, because he didn't like their questions, their news, this and that, one day, if he doesn't like what you say artistically, your explanation, do you feel vulnerable that he will also interfere with your work, the administration, present administration of the states? Will they be, you know, take their efforts up to that artistic point?
There's no question that this is already happening. We were talking about it today, that freedom of expression is a great risk in America. This was unimaginable a few years ago. We know this happens in Iran. We know it happens to many places. Censorship happens here. I mean, this is unimaginable. But I have to tell you already, as of a year ago, and I don't say this publicly, I was very, very upset because I had a bank transaction and they held the money. And I called and I said, what's happening? They said, are you originally Iranian? And I said, yes. Why has this anything to do? And they said, so sorry, but we have automatic rule by the government that certain random... Or in Germany, I had the same experience where I had another bank. And in Berlin also, they stopped it because in my passport, it said born in Iran. There's no doubt that people like myself, artist, Muslim, immigrant, artist, whatever they make, may have a double, you know, like a mixed blessing. Unfortunately, it also works the other way. Suddenly you get the Oscar if you're Iranian or, you know, I mean, it's really, you get suddenly a lot of attention. But it's also, I really think what you just said will soon become a reality. I think that is not just us, but even an American artist could be in trouble because they choose. Last week in Brooklyn, an artist had decided to do what Tanya Bergara did in Cuba, where she put a microphone in the public square and asked each person to to come and talk about the opening of relationship between Cuba and the United States. And they arrested her and she was in prison. This American artist in Brooklyn took a monitor and a microphone and asked people to come and speak about what is going on in their country. He was taken away, he was arrested, and they demolished the installation. It was supposed to be a permanent installation. This is shocking. So, you know, you're talking about something is already happening. It's not tomorrow, it's already happening. And it's extremely worrisome. But it's not just Muslim artists, it's all artists. And I don't know how the American people will respond to this. I know how I will respond to this because I'm used to defending myself. I'm used to being an outcast. I'm used to having to speak badly about my government, and that's why I cannot go back to Iran. It's not my art. It's because what I said publicly against the government, I know that. They can care less about art because they don't understand abstract art. They won't understand dreamers. But they understand when I speak publicly, I took that risk and therefore I'm in trouble, right? So it really is a personal responsibility whether an American would like to speak back to Trump or a Turkish person. It's a risk we take. Maybe somebody shouldn't take that risk. Certainly, I cannot see my family. That was a great risk. I paid big price. So every artist, every filmmaker, every writer has to go back to themselves to say, what role do I want to play? And I'm not going to tell a Turkish artist what to do, what to say about here. It really goes back to us as the people, as the audience, as the artist. How much risk do we want to take? I'm sorry, I'm not going to Iran because I don't want to go to prison. I'm not that idealistic. I'm not interested. Yeah, it's useless passport by this point, but yes, it's expired, I think. But I have American passport. But so it really goes back to maybe it's an important moment for culture and for artists and asking that point of responsibility to ourselves, to our family, and to the world. Sorry, I'm talking too much.
Well, if I really can get away with it, so you can get away with it, don't worry.
Did you get away with
it? Any other questions? Can we continue? Okay.
There's a question there.
İngilizcem iyi değil, o yüzden Türkçe soracağım. Şimdi bir kadın sanatçı bulmuşken bu kadar da bayan izleyici varken şunu sormak istiyorum. Biraz önce pardon. Bir kadın sanatçı olarak biraz önce Amerika'da bununla ilgili bir sıkıntı yaşadığınızı söylemiştiniz. Kadın ya da erkek olmak durumuyla. Ben feminist değilim. Feminist yaklaşımlardan da hoşlanmıyorum. Pozitif ayrımcı da olsa neticede ayrımcılık var işin içinde. Aynı kültürden geldiğimiz için acaba Müslüman ülkelerde kadınlardaki bu baskı öğretilmiş veya öğrenilmiş bir duygu? Bu seti bilinçaltı olarak kabul ettiğimiz için mi Amerika'ya dahi gitseniz bununla ilgili sorun yaşadığınızı düşünüyorsunuz? Yoksa Amerika'da da gerçekten bu var mı? İyi bir iş üretilmişse bunun kadın ya da erkek tarafından üretilmiş olması durumu nasıl değiştiriyor? Teşekkür ederim.
I have to have the microphone on. It's a really important question. I make film about women and the subject of women because I am a woman. And I understand the emotions and the struggles of women more. I know also I'm often careful about not being called a feminist, and not to be a speaker for women, I've always made work about Iranian women. Unfortunately, and the Iranian woman in the way that is an extension of myself. In the West, I have a problem because there is a very simplistic reading into my work. For the longest time, they read into my work as if I'm speaking about all Muslim women, all Muslim cultures, the veil. You have no idea. So I've had to go back again and again, say, I am not the speaker of the women of Islam. I'm not an ambassador. I don't know anything. I live in New York. My work is the voice of mine and no one else. Having said that, I take a lot of pride of being a woman and being a woman artist and being an Iranian woman artist, because I think Iranian women have been major inspiration to me, because Iranian women have been under so much pressure over so many different type of dictatorships, and yet they have been fighters. And my women in the films, like Roja, like all of my work, are very fragile but very strong, like me. I won't deny the fact of my fragility and insecurity on a daily basis, but I won't deny the fact that I feel very strong. And that's what I like about being a woman. And that's what the kind of narrative I like to make, and the kind of characters that are not losers, that are not repressed. They are under oppression, but they're very powerful. And that's all I want to do. And yet, you know, living in the US, functioning in the world of the Western art, I'm always bombarded with a more stereotypical reading of my work. Like you, I'm not a feminist, I'm just a woman. And it's really up to people how they like to read. I hope I answered your question.
Can I just add something to this? Just to add something to this. An artist usually feeds on sufferings, let's say. Don't you think it's a nice opportunity for you that Trump is in power now, you'll be suffering more, and it's a nice opportunity to be more creative, despite the fact that you'll have daily sufferings. Maybe you will have a better opportunity to create more as a woman, as an artist, for the Iranian woman. You don't think so?
I think you got it really wrong. This is not about suffering. It's about reflection, really. Art is not about just showing suffering. I don't think my work is about suffering. I don't think I'm suffering. I'm a very content person, and it's about reflection. It's about mysticism. It's about the greatest work of art, film, poetry, literature. They are melancholic, but they're not about suffering. It's about human spirits. It's about reflection of the time that we live in the humanity. I don't see it in that way that you categorize. Of course, there's always pain and the good, optimism. So I'm sorry if you saw the work or me as someone who's just nagging about problems, but it's really about reflection.
I think Heinz, you elaborate as a man.
No. I won't. I will speak as a woman, no. No, I wanted to add something in relation to your question about Trump and the situation, because in Europe we feel that there have not been so much political discussions and attacks and demonstrations like in the last 2 months. So the good effect of Trump is that if you have free speech and you can talk, you can demonstrate, you go, can go into the street, you can do something against it, as long as democracy works, if it works. So this is not at all an excuse for Trump or something like that. It's just to say that we are, again, we come back to the situation of uncertainty. We are in a situation which is good for art, which is good for protest, because there has not been any political protest in a long time. It has negative sides also, because you have populist parties coming up in Europe everywhere, in France, Germany, wherever you look at, in the Netherlands. But today, the situation, the society is more politicized or more active politically as it was before. That's the good thing. And the second thing I wanted to add in relation to what we said before is about the role of galleries. We are sitting in a gallery. We are sitting in a country which has a quite complicated democratic situation at the moment, to put it softly. And still we are talking about all this. So we're talking about it because it's an art gallery and we have a wonderful artist here with very important work. So all these topics can be evoked through art as a looking glass, as I said before, on what is happening in reality. So there are also chances. There are also good aspects of the thing that we don't know where our society is going today. And I think, concerning Shirin's work, it was very important that from the 90s you had one main leitmotif in a society which didn't know anything about this leitmotif. Because I think the Iranian woman, before you came into the art world and got famous, was not really a topic. We didn't know anything about it. I don't know. It was just something which didn't exist in our public attention. And also, of course, linked to a certain form and to a big strength of this work, we noticed it. But it's also, again, art is talking about problems in a good way, in a very interesting way. And so we shouldn't be too pessimistic about all that, in the sense that we are sitting here and talking about it, seeing a beautiful show. What I said before about commercial, not commercial, doesn't seem to so right anymore, because it's a show which would be an honor for any museum to be shown, I think. So things are shifting and we don't know where they're going. What is for sure is that the old categories we had in the 80s and 90s do not work anymore, I think.
Also, I think in Turkey and Iran, if I could say, we have a very different relationship to culture and art. That it's, I think it's very different, like say in America, not Europe, because that has a longer history. In Iran, Asghar Farhadi, who makes artistic film, is a mainstream filmmaker. Everybody goes to see his film. They understand his films. Abbas Kiarostami, one of the most enigmatic filmmakers in the world, is Iranian and was loved by... The Iranian people are used to the language of allegory, poetry, incredibly artistic, difficult film, because they're a culture of poetry, really. And for us, abstraction and the idea of communication through art, through use of poetry, it's a way of life. Artists are very close to our people. Orhan Pamuk, you have here, Nuri, the great filmmaker, number of people who are a treasure to this country in terms of what they represent of the Turkish society, Turkish tradition. In the American culture, and I don't mean, again, to demonize, to trivialize, but the reality is culture is an entertainment for a lot of it. You have a vast divide between, you know, what the Oscar represents, the music world, you know, the Hollywood versus the American people. It's pure entertainment. And very rarely you see films that are visited by mass culture that are really thought-provoking or politically motivated. So what I'm trying to say is that when we speak about culture playing a major role in our society, we cannot be speaking on the same level in America than in Turkey, than in Iran, because this has already happened in Iran. You have the most subversive artist embraced by the people of Iran, you know? And it's interesting that this last few weeks when you had the problem between Iran being one of the 7 countries that was banned, suddenly the speaker of Iranian society was Asghar Farhadi, the filmmaker. The first thing they did, they published a statement why he refuses to go to US for the academy. What was his argument? He beautifully wrote something that no diplomat could have written. He's so smart. He's a great scriptwriter. He makes great films. He knows how to talk to the people on the mass level. And I was really impressed by how he stole the attention of the media. An artist from Iran became the speaker for the Iranian people. Really moving. Of course, it was good timing too. But I cannot say Jeff Koons or Cindy Sherman, which I love. Cindy Sherman is a friend of mine. Jeff Koons, no, he's not a friend of mine. I know him. But no, I'm using bad examples. I'm talking about top American artists. I don't know if they will have the same relationship to the people on there. I'm exaggerating to make a point. I'm just saying this is going to be a new change. This is a moment of American history that is going to question itself about the role of culture. But we don't have this. Even in Europe, I think it's an extremely sophisticated culture that average people see Nuri's film. They know Fatih Akin. They know Farhadi. They know me. But American culture, I'm nobody. I'm lost, really. So we're talking about a very different tapestry when we're speaking about the role of culture. You cannot generalize.
Culture is a huge country. The United States is a very, very, very big place with many different histories that go back from the beginning. If you look at American history, you always have to see that there's a totally different history and culture for the African Americans, for example, versus the Europeans that came to the United States. It's a huge, huge country. There's a lot going on the East and West Coast, but there's a lot going on in the Middle and in the South as well. And it's not all just, you know, Hicks and hot dogs. There's like, you know, a lot of things being made. There's a lot of art being created. Yes, maybe they don't rise to this level, to speak to Shirin's point, but I personally know of a lot of smaller artists that have been working for years and years. And actually, just to... A lot of my African-American artist friends in the last year or so, they're saying, oh, welcome to the party. This is where we've been our whole existence. Now it's your turn. So you have to learn from us also how to be this kind of American now.
Yes, this is why I mentioned suffering. Because you're talking about a few hundred years, maybe, which is... recent, very recent in the U.S., when I was mentioning, ironically, to Shirin about suffering, we are talking about 2,500 years of love, suffering. All the poems are built on that. There are so many stories written on that. Even my name is written on a love story, which doesn't exist in Turkish. So. I meant it ironically. Yes, you do need a little bit of suffering to create a bit more, because she's creating Iranian culture. She's not creating anything American or US. This is why.
It's very interesting you say that. Now I understand your point better. But a lot of time, Iranian people ask themselves why they have such an affinity with poetry. And you're right, because Iran has lived under dictatorship one after another, after another, after another. Lack of freedom of expression, censorship. poetry, or poetic language, seems to be the only language that transcends that kind of, but also is, it becomes it escape from the local issue, and somehow it allows a reflection that is more philosophical and universal. And for me, Abbas Kiarostami is a poet. It's truly a poet. So a lot of our filmmakers, people like me, we elaborate on that tradition of poetic language that has always gave itself a sort of a self-censorship. But consequently, it becomes very reflective and universal, etc. So you're right. I think our countries have had very dark history, very ancient dark history. People have been a victim over and over again. So have Europe, you know. And this really creates the nature of the culture we are, how we have made peace with our reality. And anyway, I understand your point better now.
I don't mean to say that we should all suffer, because whatever. But I mean, I think art has another history, let's say, for the Middle Eastern cultures, which would be difficult to explain, especially in the US. I mean, you're talking about Hollywood, which would be impossible. Anyway, I don't know if Heinz has a point to give European point of view to finalize. Put a point.
I come from Germany. 65 years ago, 70 years ago, in Nazi Germany, large parts of the artistic creation, some of the most important artists having worked in the 20s and 30s were forbidden, and their books and their paintings were burned. So I think we should see it in a more general way, not only Mideast, Middle East, or Iranian. Culture has always been something very important and very fragile. And unfortunately, with a shift of political power, one of the first things they attack is culture. Because culture is the possibility of free speech, free opinion, expression, express yourself and think, tell everybody, make public what you think about the reality at the very moment. So independently from geographic differences, I think culture is fragile, and also at the same time, it's our hope. It's our possibility. Not only contemporary art, but also cinema or literature or poetry.
Shirin, how did you choose this place over here and in the film?
Oh, this location. Oh, that's a nice jump of the subject. architecture for me, it's very important. I've been very fascinated. Well, in this. Piece, because it was so much about the opposite, is this sort of monumental modern architecture that looked like the space, and versus the barren desert, the land. For me, this opposite was very interesting in terms of what this represents of the Western culture, this iconic architecture that I find very sculptural and very monumental, versus this little figure of Roja. So if you know my work over the time, architecture has been always a very important part of the narrative of my films. Because to me, architecture is not just design. They represent societies. I've also shot in Turkey, in Mardin once, where a film that really represented Islamic architecture versus Christian architecture, which I shot in New York. And in many of my work, they become really useful in terms of the narrative.
Any other questions? Okay, I think we should thank you for your presence. Thank you.